Well, we'll talk about this afternoon for about so. This project that was undertaken by Ballintoy Archaeological Historic Society, a very long and grand title. They'll be on the tour between 2013 and the beginning of 2014 with the support of the Heritage Lottery Fund to look at some aspects of hidden history in Ballintoy. I know this course or series of lectures has predominantly looked at industrial heritage. You're not going to get that today, I'm afraid. It's the same area along the Antrim coast where we were looking at the last few weeks, but it's more just what the bits of the project we were looking at, where we looked at three sites, a church site, a castle site, and a large house, which was also the site of a school in the 18th century, which I'll talk about in a bit in a moment, and tell you the difference in them. But really, the group itself, we'll just call it Ballintoy, that's the group just for shorthand. It's a very new group. It was only set up in 2010. Like all these local townlands or collections of townlands and parishes, there's a real increased awareness of their history and heritage, and Ballintoy didn't want to be left out of what other lesser areas were doing. We wanted to be there with them. And we set this group up, and initially it was a very small group, and we didn't really know what we were going to do. But some of us in the group had been involved in the archaeological dig that had been going on, led by the University of Ulster with support from Queen's Archaeological Department at Dunluce, that very well-known project that was led by Colin Breen. And some of us had been to Dunluce to take part in that dig with Colin. Colin's project was very much about getting the community involved. And that's probably why we have archaeological in our title, because what we have found is that the majority of work that's been done in local history at the moment has not been done by professional historians. It's been done by archaeologists. And they really are leading the way. Now, we don't want to forget the professional historians either, see this particularly as some of us come through a history background. But you know, I think that partly explains why. But arising from that, there was a lot of interest in what was happening in the North Coast. It really has accelerated the interest in local history and heritage in that area. There's a lot of new groups have sprung up in the area in the last few years. We're not the only one. And it has revived a few that were suffering a little bit. They've been around for much longer, but really was a decision that we should take on a project. It just shouldn't be a history group that would invite people to come and listen to a monthly lecture, as useful as that is. That we should actually get out, get our hands dirty, literally digging, surveying, and then also in archives digging as well. So we're trying to ride the two horses at the one time. And we talked to Colin about this, so we came up with three sites: Templastic Church, Ballintoy Castle, and White Park House and school, which is in White Park Bay, which we'll come to at the end of the talk. And we'd say we'd focus on those three sites, but although bits and pieces were known about them, and the course of conversations people would refer to, really very little was known about them in terms of a coherent way of putting them together in the local community. Now, the next sort of four bullet points you say there are gobbledygook, and I detest gobbledygook. But when you're applying for money from funding organisations, you have to use gobbledygook. And so really what we wanted to do was, we were a new group, and we wanted to increase the ability of the members of the group to do research themselves, whether it be in the field or whether it be in archives like PRONI or libraries. But not only that, we didn't want it just to be a small group within the society. We wanted to involve as many of the society as possible, but also the whole community. And we took that very seriously, and we had outreach events, which I'll touch on in a wee moment, to get the community involved. Also, there were stories about this site, these sites that were very conflicting, and we wanted to challenge some of those stories and see which ones were legend, which ones, not that there's anything wrong with legend, and which ones were more factual. And I suppose more significantly, we wanted to actually influence what local government, for example, was doing in the area, what the NAEA were doing in the area, what DECAL were doing in the area, see this were in PRONI, and try to influence how our story was being told. Now, I have to say, when I use the word our story, you'll know from my accent that I am not anywhere ever in my life from North Antrim. Some North Antrim people sitting at the back showing their natural North Antrim and shyness and reticence that they try to tell me they have, but which I can assure you is a myth. I was from Tyrone, but I've been in that area for about 20 odd years, 30 years maybe, so I'm still a blow in. But I was involved with the group as well, and I must say, although people talk about that Robert led the project, maybe I did, but the project would never have succeeded and achieved what it did, except for the huge contribution that all the members from the group made, and some of me here today, and I'm delighted that they came all the way up, and the wider community. We launched the project on a very cold Saturday morning, on the think it was the 24th of February 2013, at 10 o'clock in the morning. It had to be early in the morning because it was the Six Nations started that afternoon, so we had to get our priorities absolutely right. So a freezing cold morning, we went to Plaster Churches. This is a standing in the body of the church at the Plaster Churches. I'll tell you where it is in a moment. With a very knowledgeable geographer pointing at the stones, who knows absolutely nothing about the stones. He's not an archaeologist, he's not a historian, but what he does know about is how to involve communities in participating in projects, and that was his role. And Colin wasn't available that morning, so Dr. Max Hope from Coleraine University stood in to do that for us. We were very grateful. It was freezing cold. Whether it justified us going to this lady here, unfortunately can't be with us today, for some 16-year-old Scotch whisky at 11 o'clock in the morning, is neither here nor there, but it really did impress the archaeologists. And we got tremendous support during the rest of the project. So there was really sort of three main phases to the project. I'll do them very quickly. I'm not going to talk too much about them because of the time, but first phase is what we call exploring. Some people call it research. And first thing we had to learn about, we all go to these sites, and some of these sites some of our people have been going to for years, but we never look at anything. Or if we do go to them, we read what somebody else has written on the panel and take it as gospel, and don't think of it challenging it ourselves or finding out information about it ourselves. So the first thing here, this is at Ballymargy in Ballycastle, where Colin took a group of about 25 of us on the 23rd of March, the day before the huge snow in 2013, to teach us not about the history of Ballymargy as such, but how to read an archaeological site, how to look for different materials that are used in the site, how to look for bits that were built at different times, how to look at the wider landscape that the site sits in, rather than just looking at the four walls or the number of walls there at Ballymargy. Second stage then was to go and look at archives. We came to PRONI. We were very well looked after by Ian and his colleagues, the Organise colleagues, and how to use PRONI. Some of us have been here before, and to use the archives that they have here. But also we went to the old kids at Linhall Library, and this is us in the Monuments and Historic Buildings Record in the NIEA, which at that time was in Hill Street. And then we thought we would do some surveying. Now, there was no actual archaeological digging involved in our project, but what we did do was archaeological surveys, particularly out from Plaster. And this is to a young archaeological graduate, PhD graduate, which is qualified very recently at that time, teaching us how to conduct a survey. But we were very lucky. There were a couple of very good two guys who came and said, we know nothing about archaeology, we know nothing about surveys, but they both were tradesmen, and they knew an awful lot about surveying, which was actually very, very useful for those of us who knew absolutely nothing about it. Now, I'll show you that, well, what we had to achieve further on. Also, we were, as I said, you know, we were very determined that we weren't just going to keep all this information to ourselves, that we were going to take it out into the community for two reasons. One, to collect information that we know is in the community that we didn't know, and two, to try and tell them anything we had discovered. So we held, this is about through a vintage rally, a big annual event in Ballintoy every June, second Saturday in June. So we held, that was our sort of first attempt at outreach. We had a stall at that. You were talking there about days of your 1916 open day. We held an event in St. Joseph Hall, Main Street Ballintoy, where we encouraged people to bring maps, photographs, let us scan them if they wouldn't mind, explain to us what they were. We put on some stuff as well to show them what we had found. And this is some stalwarts of the society starting to scan the material. And then we went further than that, that we organised near the end of the project, we organised guided tours around the three sites to again tell people about the sites and what we had found. And then, very important to somebody, anybody that knows me, this bit here, the celebrating bit. And also the reason why I have photographs there was just sort of touching the success of the project, why these projects are valuable and worthwhile. When we set the project up, the first meeting we had to talk about it, we were very delighted that we got an audience of eight to turn up just to talk about whether we'd apply for the funding, and if we did apply for what we'd apply for. Eight was quite good. And the project got going, that went up to about 18. And towards the end of the project, there was in there 25, 26 people who were actively involved in the project, like not just on the fringes, all actively involved in the project. And the exhibition that there's just such kind words about the display here. We had to have an event, the HLF assisted, you have an event, and rightly so, to celebrate the success of the project and show people what you've done. We had to move to our third venue to get a venue that was big enough to hold it. The Joseph's Hall was too small, the Church of Ireland Parish Hall was too small, and just by coincidence a public house was able to, and the reception room was able to take us, and we had over 100 people there. And that shows the success of these projects that they never should be underestimated about how the community get involved and what the community have to offer. And that's really enough about the project. I want to now look at the three sites that we worked on, and I suppose the first site in a way for us picked itself, and that was Templaston Church. This site, for those of you who don't know the area, first of all, for those of you who don't know where Ballintoy is, I suspect nobody doesn't know where Ballintoy is, where the road bridge is. Ballintoy is sort of halfway between the Giant's Causeway and the town of Ballycastle. Okay? And there's a little harbour before you get to Ballintoy called Port Braddon, where there's a salmon fishery. And just on the road down to that harbour's very back corner, and across the fields, you will see a little stone structure. You may not have seen it, and I wouldn't criticise if you hadn't, because most of the locals didn't look very much at it either. Okay? It's an innocent little stone building room, and there's two graveyards. And the graveyards are denominated by the very interesting names of the Irish graveyard and the Scotch graveyard. So the people buried in them do not fit into those nice easy categories as some people would like to suggest, but again it's very good when you're applying for funding to the site that it might. This is the site here, this is the sea here, obviously the cliffs, and this is the Irish graveyard, which has the room, and then just about 60 metres to the northwest, you have the Scotch graveyard. Now it's supposedly called the Scotch graveyard because when the Scots settlers arrived, they preferred to be buried in this graveyard, supposedly because it was near Scotland, but it is only 60 metres. I have to say there is a lot of names in here that are very definitely Scottish, but there are also some Scottish names in the Irish graveyard as well. Okay? But everybody who now goes to the site sees the ruin here in the Irish graveyard. But over here in the Scotch graveyard, we found the foundations of another church. Now, I'm not going to claim that nobody didn't know they were there. Amateur archaeologists from the 19th century had established we were there. But our role was to make sure that that story wasn't lost and to add a bit to it if we could, and I think we have. Now, it's possible that there has been a church at Templastra since the time of St. Patrick. There's a reference in the tripartite life of St. Patrick, which I think was written in the 6th, 7th century, to him blessing a church called Sean Donnock, and I'm not an Irish historian, so that's not pronounced in Irish language better, so that's not pronounced correctly, forgive me. And he blessed a church near Dunseverick called Sean Donnock. And it is very possible that it was an earlier church on this site. It would have been a wooden church, but there's no evidence of it, none whatsoever. But in the Scotch graveyard, there is evidence of a church that would be dated by our professional archaeologists about the 10th century, because they didn't start really building stone churches until about the 10th century and 8th, 10th century. The foundations are about 7 metres long, probably possibly longer than that. It's very hard to be exact about the length because there's modern graves that eat into it and we couldn't touch them. About 5.5 metres wide. Okay? And the foundation is very, very clear. And there's one lady sitting at the back who had the job, I'm not embarrassed for making her stand up, of plotting all of this outline of the stones that have survived onto graph paper while we measured them. And I think my job is not a surprise, most people know how loud my voice is shouting out what the measurement was to her while she plotted onto graph paper. But there definitely has been a 10th century church here. Just the foundations, just the trace of it. But what's probably more interesting is the legends that are associated with this church. There's a legend that survived on this site that in fact this church was never built. Okay, it never got above a few feet. And the legend is that when those who were building it each night, this miraculous force came along, knocked down what had been built the night before, and lo and behold, there was a beaming light that pointed to building the church somewhere else, and of course the place that the light pointed to was where the medieval church now stands. You can believe that story if you want, or not. So it's entirely up to yourself. So the builder decided not to finish the church here and moved across to where the Irish graveyard is now in the current route. It's a lovely story, it's part of the folklore, it's part of the folklore of the area. But of course, whether you believe the story or not, it may explain the name Templastra. And the name Templastra, the townland of Templastra, takes its name as the Church of the Flame or the Flaming Church. Okay? So it could be to do with that legend, but it's more likely to have to do with the fact that the patron of the church was St. Lassier, or St. Lazarus, depending how you pronounce it. Okay? So it's probably more likely that the last stands for church of St. Lass, of St. Lass. But I prefer the flame of the church title, particularly if you're not too keen to go to church early in the morning like myself, and you prefer to have to go to that flame of the church. So, which is just up a row. But that is where the name comes from. But obviously most people are more interested in the ruin that has survived in the Irish. That's just an aerial view of it. There's the foundations here in the Scots graveyard. It's all the way around this type of thing. The foundation of the Scots graveyard, the Texas Irish Stone Church. And here then in the Irish graveyard is the ruin of the medieval church. This is what the medieval church looks like today, what the ruin looks like. Archaeologists who were doing broad surveys of churches, and this is no way intended as a criticism, because the archaeologist who was doing the work was doing a survey of churches right across Ulster, so she didn't have time to look at the detail of every individual church. But for a long time it was thought that this church was a plantation church, or an early 1600s church. Okay? View on that has changed, and we now think that it's a late 14th, early 15th century church. It seems to be the trend in studying similar churches that they think that they're slightly earlier than what they previously did think. Massive reforms in the Irish church in the 12th, 13th century, and parishes, new parishes being formed, and the idea of parishes being introduced and a lot of new chapels of ease were built as part of that. Because where Clonplaster stands in medieval Ireland was in the parish of Billy. Today it's in the parish of Ballintoy, but at that time it was in the parish of Billy. And when you look at the papal taxation records for the early 13th century, the parish of Billy was one of the richest parishes in North Antrim. And it's possible that this church at Clonplaster was built as a chapel of ease for the parish church in Billy, which is just a few miles inland. Now you can see from that photograph a fair wee bit about the church. It's a small church, it's not a cathedral, it's not on that scale, okay? It's about 15 metres long approximately, about 6 metres wide, okay? The east gable here, facing east with the east window, is fairly distinguishable. And the north wall and the south wall are still very much in good standing given the age of the church. The walls are varied between 2.5 and 3 metres high in places. They're 80 centimetres thick, which is a fairly standard size for walls of that period. And you can see that sort of the grass and the moss along the top is helping to protect them. You'll also notice here the west gable has been very badly damaged. This is where the door would have been here into the church, and we'll talk about this cross in this side just in a wee moment. So a fairly good idea of what the church looked like. We think it would probably have been thatched with heather. And I'll talk about a couple of other features inside the church in a wee minute, but I want to now turn to this cross here. This cross, situated in the north corner of the west gable, is not in its original location. And the stone that the cross is made of is very different from the nailing stones in the church. The bulk of the stones in the middle of the church are basalt, same as the giant's cosmic stone, for the better, one of a better word. Description, and obviously it was held together with lime mortar. But this stone here is very, very different. And we know from the Ordnance Survey memoirs of 1833 that this stone was lying in a ditch nearby. And what it is thought is that this stone, had been in the site of the church in the Scotch graveyard near to the sea, the 10th century church. And some people, the geologists who know about stone, actually think this stone is more typical of County Derry than it is of North Antrim. Okay, that also could be very possible. But you can see here, this people think the cross is that crack down the stone. It's not. The cross is here and here, formed with circles and bands. So we know in 1838 there was a field nearby, and the thinking is that it was from the earlier 10th century church. But we know that by 1887 it had been moved, and we know that amateur archaeologists in the 19th century did an awful lot of good work in recording what was happening at sites, but they also did some DIY as well, and some of it was good and some of it wasn't so good, and I suspect this stone was put there as part of that DIY. It's the principal feature of the church. These are just some of our surveys, because we're particularly proud of these surveys that we did. This is the east window here, the east gable. And you'll see rows of little holes here. What are archaeological terms are known as put logs. And the thinking is that scaffolding was put in here, put a log in, wooden scaffolding, was put in as the church started to build up and up and up. And other alternative is that they've been used as strapping purposes for the roof. But the consensus is that they were used for scaffolding. This is the, in all of our drawings, this is the south elevation. Again, you see the row of put logs that we think were used for scaffolding. Then you see a much bigger one here. And that was what is known as an ambulary, where the communion vessels and communion implements were kept. And then here, the site of a dilapidated window. That is not a window, that's just stone fall. But we're very confident that was a window there. There are many legends and stories associated with the church, as well as the archaeological detail. The one I like best is a story about a man called Daniel Lamon. It's recorded in the Ordnance Survey memoirs, and he supposedly around 1780 took stones. By that stage, his church was no longer in use, and I'll come back to that. Took the stones from the altar to use for farming purposes and for sharpening tools. And the local tradition is that he immediately took dysentery. But he survived that and he recovered from that. But then in 1813 he fell over a bridge. And of course the dysentery and the falling over the bridge in 1813 were directly the result of having had stolen stones from the altar of the plaster church. I suppose me being the cynic would probably be worth to know, was there a fair in Ballintoy that day and would there have been any drink taken? But you should not be scurrilous about the dead. But it's just as good a theory. What we do know is that there was a priest's house on the site. It was about 320 yards inland from the site. But the priest's house and a priest's well, but they had a causeway between the two, but they were taken away by a man called David Hill in 1800. Through the end of the church, and the church ceased to be used, nobody really knows when that was. There's no consensus on that. But based on the evidence of other things that were going on at that time, the local story is that it was used by Cromwell's army. Now, Robert Cromwell was not in North Antrim in the 1650s, but his army, 1640s, 1650s, but his army was. And he was at Ballycastle, and he was at Dunluce. And of course, one of the stories is that Cromwell's army used it to store ammunition or to keep their horses, and Cromwell had a reputation for keeping his horses in churches. So that is possible, okay? It was, I suspect, ceased to be used as a church at that time anyhow, because there's a church in Ballintoy, you may all know, it's probably the most photographed church in Ulster, the White Church. Well, that church, there's been a church on that site since at least the 1630s. Okay, now it's not the current church was built in 1813, but there's been a church on that site since the 1630s, because what we're going to talk about in a moment was the castle. The Stuart family had built up Ballintoy Castle, and of course they wanted the church in their backyard, essentially. They were starting to use that church. So it all fits in that probably the church ceased to be used around the 1630s, 1650s. It does appear, the site does appear on the down survey maps of the 1650s, but the church would appear not to be in use at that stage. One of the things when we were involving the community in the project was, they said, at the end of this project, we would like to know what these places looked like. So we employed a fellow called Philip Armstrong, who is probably the leading archaeological illustrator in Northern Ireland. He does an awful lot of work with NEA and for academic archaeologists. And we gave him our evidence, and he had evidence of his own, we went and got. And he came up with, in discussion with professional archaeologists and ourselves, this is what we think the church looked like. Now, the cross may appear, I think, it's a little bit of artistic license, and we openly admit that, but it was only, obviously, there's a lot of children, and we wanted to use these cards, because we had postcards and posters and one thing and another from them. That is what we think the church looked like. It's very, very similar to other churches of that period, and not only in Ireland, but also in the western Isles of Scotland as well. When we started the project, we picked and plastered church. And then we talked about, could we do a couple of other sites? And the next one we came up with was Ballintoy Castle. And I have to be honest, when we picked the sites, we didn't actually see the connections between the sites. And we didn't really think, is there a connection between the sites? We just picked three sites at random. Nothing wrong with that approach. Sometimes it works very well. So The next one we picked was Ballintoy Castle. Now, this area here, this is the harbour, Ballintoy. Then you come up the wee steep twisty road, Coast Guard station here. And you come to a bend in the road, that's where the current Ballintoy Parish Church is. And then there's a clacking of farmhouses here, mainly occupied by the members of the McShane family. And that was the site of Ballintoy Castle. No difficulty identifying where the site was, because the site still to this day is referred to as the castle. Though it is tending to go into decline, younger people aren't using it so much, and that was part of the reason why we wanted to do the project about it, so that the traditions and the stories and the heritage wouldn't get lost. So this was just from a postcard, probably 1950s, castle, which was slightly earlier. Castle Ballintoy, County Antrim. So we had something to work with. And obviously because it was a castle, bits were known about it, in fact more was known about it, and it was easy to find out about, and to emplaster the church. It's very much associated with the Stuart family, who dominated around Ballintoy from the 1620s onto the 1750s, just in ballpark, terms. They're very much associated with Ballintoy Castle, though there is a story locally, and the sources are divided on this, that there was a small castle on that site prior to the Stuart Castle. George Hill, he says it's a MacDonald Castle. Doesn't say that MacDonald's built in it, he doesn't say MacDonald's lived in it, it just says a MacDonald's castle. But another source, Hill, refers to that it was lived in and built, certainly lived in, by an Irish chieftain called Mulderic. Now the story is, the legend is, and it's recorded in history books, as well as an old tradition, that the Stuarts wanted this land, to lease this land from for Sheriff of Antrim, and that they either murdered Mulderic or had him murdered. Okay? So there's all that tension going on in the background of early 17th century Ballintoy. But certainly, by the 8th of March 1625, Archibald Stuart leases Ballintoy Castle and the town lands of Ballintoy from the Earl of Antrim on the 8th of March 1625. Now, the Stuarts had been from the Isle of Bute. They had been in Ulster from 1560. And the Isle of Bute, they got involved in a war, I suppose is the only word to call it, battle, against Mary Queen of Scots. They picked the wrong side, they lost. In those days, when you picked the wrong side and you lost, you also forfeited your lands. They had been the hereditary sheriffs of the Isle of Bute. So they found themselves out of favour, out of power, and they found their lands being sold off to other people. And so the first settler that we could name was a James Stuart, who came to Dunseverick first in 1560. And then his grandson, Archibald Stuart, is the one who takes the lease in March 1625 from there. And here we have on the Downs survey, here, which are held here in PRONI, a nice representation of the map of the area. And you see here, Stuart House. We call it Ballintoy Castle, but of course it was called Stuart House. And again, for anybody who's budding genealogists in the room, genealogists, notice how the Stuart was spelled. It was spelled as Stuart. So names do change, and how spellings of names do change over time, and it's referred to as house. This is a representation of the church, and that the village is not where it is now in Ballintoy, but that it was much closer to the castle, built around the castle. So this map dates from 1654. So the church is there, which ties in with the replacement of the Templaster church with this church, and the Stuarts coming to the area. We all know how much we rely on the Ordnance Survey memoirs, not just to tell us what life was like in Ireland in the 1830s, 1840s, but equally we rely on to tell us what it was like much earlier than that because of the absence of other sources that go into that sort of detail. And we're lucky that some of the information about the castle is recorded in the Ordnance Survey memoir for 1838 because the castle was knocked down in 1800. So the ordnance officers, as they did all over, interviewed local people and recorded detail about the castle. Basically we know that it's not a castle, it's children's day castle, and I suppose just to think what it may have looked like, you're thinking of something like Ballygally Castle. I'll show you a picture of it in a moment, how we reconstruct it. Something like Ballygally Castle was Scots baronial style, very distinctive style. Now, it was quite an impressive building. We know that from the Ordnance Survey memoirs, with outbuildings, gardens, handsome fish ponds, courtyards, and other enclosures. It was built of stone again and lime, mortar. As I've said, it was situated beside the new church, and the village grew up around it. And the Stuarts had it until the 1750s. But the descendants of Archibald Stuart were perhaps not as frugal as he was. Now, not so much this gentleman, though he was pretty loose with his cash as well. But this gentleman's father, Alexander Thomas Stuart — I don't have a photograph of Alec Thomas Stuart Sr., so I'll have to show you a photograph of Alec Thomas Stuart Jr., but I'll come to him in a moment as well. Alec Thomas Stuart Sr. decided that in 1759 that he would sell the castle and the estate, and he sold it to a Belfast man called Mr. Couples, about whom we know very, very little, but we don't really need to know that much about him, because the very sort of next couple of months he sold it to a Dr. Alexander Fullerton, and that's why when you go to Ballintoy today you have Fullerton Arms in Ballintoy. He had made his money as a doctor in Jamaica, and he bought the estate in 1760. The Alexander Thomas Stuart — and this again is how the history of all these areas are interconnected — after the sale of the Ballintoy estate, the Stuart family had married into a family in Acton at Points Pass in County Armagh, and he goes to Acton and was involved with building parish church there and houses and one thing and another. So the connection between the two places, and we're trying to reconnect the two places in terms of the two local houses, say it's in the two areas. But his father, Alexander Thomas Stuart, you know, his mother referred to him as graceless, largely because of his loose spending and his extravagant lifestyle in Dublin, and he's got a bad press. But actually, when you look more closely at him, you do see that although he was loose with his money, he also was very interested in building up and promoting Ballintoy. And just before he sold the estate, about 20 years before he sold the estate, he was applying to the government in Dublin to get loans to help him develop the first man-made harbour at Ballintoy in the 1750s, but ultimately he bankrupted himself, and the estate was sold. A couple of interesting sort of little stories about the castle. This is Alexander Fullerton here, who bought the estate. He was a doctor that was in Jamaica. He bought the estate for £20,000. He had no family, so he left the estate to his niece, and his niece had married a Mr. Downing from Ballachie, but a tradition that still continues in rural Ulster to this day. The terms of acquiring the property was that Mr. Downey had to take the Fullerton name. And so he became George Alexander Downing Fullerton. And depending whether you're in Ballachie or whether you're in Ballintoy, depends on whether the Fullerton comes before the Downing or the Downing comes before the Fullerton. So it can be very confusing at times if you're talking about the same person. But the Downing family of Ballachie, you know, married into the Fullertons, but that's the connection, between two places that are geographically quite apart in Northern Ireland. But there's all these connections that you start to unravel when you do the research. The Downing family, distant descendants of, are the Downing family who bequeathed the land that Downing Street in London sits on or stands on. And of course, the local diehards in Ballintoy are very proud of that attachment and very quick to tell you when you do any research. But there's another story that they're very quick to tell you as well, and that is that when Fullerton decided he had had enough of the castle, he held a massive big auction in 1783, and it is said that the oak panelling and the staircases were sold off and taken to Downing College in Cambridge, because the Downing family had connections and had bequeathed a lot of money to Downing College in Cambridge. And when you read stuff about Ballintoy or talk to some of the local people about it, they're very quick to tell you this story. And I have to say, I admire the bravery of an archaeologist. I wouldn't have done it, and anybody from Ballintoy who hears me repeating this story must not take it back. I admire the bravery of Tom McAlean, archaeologist at the University of Ulster, who came to Ballintoy. He gave a talk about a completely different subject, but in the best interest of local history, straight onto this story. And said, actually, that story is a load of rubbish. You know, the Downing family of England did bequeath this college, but there's no evidence to support the staircase. we don't believe him. Just simple as that. He hadn't produced enough evidence that his story is correct, and we don't believe him. Our story. But I thought he was enormously brave. This is what we think the castle looked like. The correct archaeological time for the castle, a house, big house, Scots baronial style, your turrets and your curved walls, stone wall rounded, and our representations of a fairly formal ornate gardens, and then the village and the church, quite a simple church here in the background. The drawings of the plaster church and the drawings of Ballintoy Castle, we had no difficulty with. We had plenty of evidence. And we were quite happy. The professional archaeologists were quite happy, so that gave us confidence and they had a big input to it. And we do follow up. Our next site and final site I'm going to talk about, we had a lot more questions. You've all been to meetings. You're coming to the end of the meeting and think, well, we'll do a plaster school, sorry, the plaster church, we'll do a Ballintoy Castle. And a little voice, which is always nice to hear, said, why don't we do something about a big house that was in White Park Bay? To which some of the straightforward and straight-talking members of the Ballintoy group said, well, get yourself on. Who in their right mind would have built a big house down in that God-forsaken exposed place? Words to that effect, but perhaps slightly more colourful words in between. whether or not the clergyman was there or not. But there is a story that were known that there had been a large house down amongst the dunes at White Park Bay, and that that had been the site of an 18th century school. It was added on a wee bit, I think, to our project at the start, but very soon became really the talking point. I think we did the most work on Templastra, but the bit that probably caused the most talk locally and speculation and carry on and was probably this here, White Park School or White Park House. It stands at the west end of White Park Bay, the Port Bradon end of White Park Bay, and there's three archaeological sort of ruins. This being the main one here, which some of you will know as the old youth hostel. The other public toilets. Then over here, another one. I need to go to the next one. That's the second one. And then there's this wall structure here. Now, on the advice of professional archaeologists, we left that bit there out of our project. They weren't that keen to go there just at this stage. We'll go back to that another time. And we focused on the bit that was the, this bit here, that was the original youth hostel and public toilets. And this is where they in archives answers an awful lot of questions. Because the doubting Thomases, and there were many of them, that there was not a house at White Park Bay, had to, like Paddy Ashton, eat their hat when this photograph was turned up. Now, when I say it turned up, some of us had an idea where it was. It's from the Green Collection, what I still call the Austin Folk and Transport Museum. I'm going too old to call them those. from the Green Collection. Now, if you go back, sorry, I went the wrong way. To here, just see that little return wall there. Yeah, this is the youth hostel. Let's go forward. So that's the bit. It was the youth hostel that was still standing. There is the return. And then there is the house that is no longer there. And when I tell you that this house was built in 1740, it's described in the Ordnance Survey Memorandum, and I think this is where some of the locals had the difficulty, because you've got to treat with care the wording used by an early to mid-19th century commentator compared with the wording we use today. It's described in the Ordnance Survey Memorandum as an extensive mansion. So I think some of our people we're thinking of something like Mount Stuart, if you know what I mean. But bear in mind that when you look at the census record, or much later, or two, you know, say 100 years later, 150 years later, most people in Ballintoy were still living in 1-2 bedroom cottages. The only large house was the rectory, the trail lived in. will still stand if they built in 1791. A house like this with three windows along the top and a window either side of the door, a return extensive building here, though this photograph was taken in the 1920s, so it's in ruin, you know, would have been extensive mansion in the context of Ballintoy stroke North Antrim. And this here photograph helped address all that. And we know that the house was built by a John Stuart Esquire. He was a member of the Stuart family of Ballintoy Castle. And that has sort of answered that. We've some great local stories about this place. This dune, which is much smaller now, is known locally as Strawberry Hill. We had a little Esau's on a field trip to the site at the very early stage of the project. One of the local ladies again, this is Strawberry Hill. We could find along here where the edge of the sand dunes run down to the beach, you can see a limestone wall that is definitely man-made and may well be like a boundary wall. There's a local story that there was a school here, which I'm going to talk about in more detail in a minute, but one of the local stories associated with the site is that there was what they call in North Antrim a ball alley. I can't do Ulster Scots, I'm sorry, I'm a Norman English. But a ball alley that would have been used, you know, for playing a ball sport, either by the residents of the house or the pupils of the school. Morris McCurdy down there could pronounce it a lot better than I can. So there's all these stories that were associated with the site. And then we come back to this bit of the story that it was a school. Because much to my disgust, and it's only mild disgust to me, but if you're from Ballintoy for six generations, it's much to your great disgust. It says in the beginning of the ordnance survey members for the parish of Ballintoy, not much ever happened in Ballintoy, and there's not much of note. Now, he must have had a very bad night the night before to say something so uncharitable about Ballintoy. But in the very next sentence, the army officer writes on the fair sheet, however, there is a story that Viscount Castlereagh was educated partly in the parish. And this is where the story of the school comes from. The story of the school is that there was a school here, house built 1740s, that there was a school in this house that Stuart lived in for the education, this house described in the Ordnance Survey Memoirs, for the education of the young gentlemen of the gentry of the area. And that the Stuarts went there, the castle, that the McNaughtons of Bush Mills went there, a family called Whaley, who I'd like to know more about, I think they're from Ballycastle, and of course there's a connection with probably the Whaleys of Dublin, they were a very famous family in Dublin. And then the story that Castlereagh would have went there. Now, we don't have any hard evidence that Castlereagh went there, but Dr. Anne Casement, who knows a lot about the Londonderry family and the Londonderry archive, we spoke to Anne about this. But the National Trust, I like this story and use this story on their interpretive panel at White Park Bay, saying that Castlereagh went there. They also tell the story that it's a school for young gentry, then the next line say it was a head school. I think it's unlikely it was both. It certainly wasn't both at the one time, you know. There's no doubt about that. Okay. But we spoke to Anne, who knows, as I say, a lot about the Londonderry family. And she said, Robert, what you would really need to get is a connection between the teacher of the school and Castlereagh. So we knew the teacher of the school was described as a Mr. Stark. And we had a fair idea that the Mr. Stark was a clergyman. And from the records of Kilfeatrum Parish Church, we knew that Stark had been the rector of Kilfeatrum from 1770 to 1777. And a part of another project then involved in, I'm at the moment working my way through the vestry books of the 18th century vestry books, early 19th century vestry books of Ballintoy Parish. And so I went to the 1770s to start to see any references to Stark. And in 1772, Stark was the curate in Ballintoy Church. Now, churches of the 18th century, early 19th century are not like churches now where the rector stays at the parish. Usually the rector stays as far away from the parish as you possibly can and sends somebody else to do a lot of the work for him in those days. So Stark was certainly in the area. Still no connection with Robert Stuart, Viscount Castlereagh, the famous Foreign Secretary. Still struggling. We know, everybody knows, I think, that Castlereagh was born in 1769 and he dies by taking his own life in 1822. And we also know that for some unknown reason, I cannot understand, He went to the Royal School of Armagh in 1777, where he did good in Gallen and Tyrone, and where I'm from, I can't understand it. But we know he went there aged 8. So we're really narrowing down what school he went to and everything else. We've got Sturrock, who we think is the connection between the two, at Ballintoy in 1770 and 1772. And all that we can assume is that prior to Stuart, and it is an assumption based on an old tradition, that prior to 1770, he went to Royal School of Armagh, he must have been in North Antrim and went to this school. But the link, the only link that we were able to get between Stuart and Castlereagh, that's what the whole thing spins on, is that Stuart goes on to have a very successful, relatively successful career within the Church of Ireland. And whenever Castlereagh has been prepared to go to Oxford or Cambridge, probably to Oxford, been prepared to go to Oxford later on in his life, late teens, Stuart is the Chancellor of Down Cathedral. And Stuart and another reverend gentleman from the area are preparing, educating Castlereagh for going to university in England. Okay. So there are connections between the family. Now, how long he attended the school or how often he attended the school in Ballintoy, we don't know, and he might never have attended it. But at least we have been able to build up a link between the two and give a bit more credence to the story. Of course, that's Robert Stuart, Lord Castlereagh himself. And Ian got that. Thanks for that comment. As I said, reproducing the drawing of the site for the other two was fairly easy. And we were really struggling a bit with this one. And this is the best that we have that we can come up with. It is a bit more tentative than the other two. But thankfully, from the photograph in the Green Collection in the Public Transport Museum, they were fairly confident. This would be a substantial house here, the three ones on the top. Substantial by mid-18th century standards in North Antrim. And this would be where the youth hostel is now. And that's where the stump of the other room is. We just forgot about the wall right here. We gave us too much bother at this stage. We'll get back to it sometime. What we do know is that the house fell into disrepair about 1800. It had been a Stuart house. Fultons must have been his interest in. This land was increasingly used for agricultural purposes, still is to this day, even though it's amongst the sand dunes. But what we do know is that the house was a water guard base, which is like a forerunner of customs and excise. Basically, they were here, I don't understand why they really need for it, to prevent smuggling and illicit distillation, poaching, if I want a better word, in North Antrim. I can't imagine that there was any of that going on, but they felt that there should be a water guard based here, and he patrolled the coast with a boat to make sure what was going on in that area. We're still reasonably confident and reasonably happy that this is broadly what the site looked like. We will go back and do more work here. And our project came to an end early 2014. We had an exhibition which we travelled about various places. We were very grateful that PRONI allowed us to display it here, particularly because of the archive. We used the archives here as part of our project. The next stage of our work, we're probably, we don't want to rest on our laurels, we're thinking of doing an oral history project. And as part of that project, we're probably going to, as part of this webinar, so interested in this series of lectures. I think as part of that project, we're obviously going to look at employment and industries and what people worked at. And so that will take us into things like limestone, lime kilns, coal, the harbour, the salmon fishery, the rope bridge. And that will be the next stage of our project. Thank you all very, very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoy it.